It's a science fiction dream waiting to become a reality. Driverless cars navigating city streets and freeways safely and autonomously, allowing passengers to sit back, relax, and watch a movie, catch up on work, or read a book. It's been 80 years since the idea first appeared on the pages of science fiction novels. The technology has come a long way since then, but there's still lots of work to do before self-driving cars are a common sight on city streets.
Once you get it, you know, even the speeds you have on a secondary road, you're way past the speed that you can stop before every obstacle. So you need to be able to predict ahead of the car, you know, to see the pedestrian crossing and make some intelligent guess about which way they're going to go. It seems simple, but it raises, you know, an order of magnitude the degree of intelligence you need in the car.
The Computer History Museum opened a new exhibit that looks at the history and current state of self-driving cars. With Google, Toyota, and Nissan all working hard at the technology, it's quite possible that a self-driving car revolution will come about in our own lifetime. Google's efforts are the most talked about today, and it may be closer than anyone to bringing self-driving cars to the mass market. The company's goal is to eventually create a self-driving car that operates without any human intervention. It says its self-guided Prius and Lexus cars have logged over 700,000 miles since 2009 without any accidents. Taking a look at the car on show here, and one of the first things you notice is a small spinning device on the roof. Inside is a LiDAR sensor, the laser version of radar that gives the car a 360-degree view of what's around it. The drum spins at 10 times per second, shooting low-powered laser beams in every direction and creating a map of the car's environment. Other sensors are located in the wheel hub and interior of the car. A radar sensor on the front grille detects vehicles up ahead and measures their speed, so that the car can slow down or speed up on the road. Google software interprets hundreds of objects around the car with distinct shapes. From its driving tests, Google has developed models for different situations that might arise on the streets to help the software predict how other drivers, cyclists, and pedestrians are likely to act. The self-driving car makes driving decisions by combining those models with its map of the road and the real-time information about its surroundings that comes from the sensors. Google may be synonymous with driverless cars now, but the concept was introduced long before Google even existed. At the 1939 World's Fair, General Motors presented its Futurama exhibit, a projection of what the world would look like in 1960. In a time before computers, GM envisioned a system in which cars were operated by radio from a central control tower.
General Motors actually tried to do this in the 50s in combination with RCA radio, and they did, you know, it worked. It's still used in test tracks today. The stumbling block is you would need to retrofit all the freeways. And there was actually a big effort to do that. There was a lot of funding went into a lot of studies, but it never hit critical mass.
Companies developing driverless car technology point to its benefits. Seniors could get to a doctor's appointment on their own, there would be less traffic congestion and safer roads with fewer accidents made by driver error. But before we hail driverless cars as the answer to the traffic jams on our streets and highways, Weber warns we should consider the risks as well. If longer commutes become more tolerable, people might be encouraged to move farther out from cities, creating urban sprawl at a level not seen before. And if cars can be driverless, whizzing around delivering packages, for instance, that could lead to even more cars on the road.
It's a very powerful technology. When this happens, it will change things a lot. It can be used either very badly or very well. So I think it'll be important that, you know, we'll really pay attention to laying the right foundation for it.
At the Computer History Museum in Mountain View, Melissa Aparicio, IDG News Service.